Greetings from chess.com. I'm very excited to cover the journey of India's 21st Grandmaster Sri Ram Jha. Fabulous birthday to Sri Ram Jha, and special thanks to him for sending three of his best games to us and for also answering all the questions. We wish him a great year ahead, and dear viewers, I have three positions for you to solve. Find out the best moves in each of these cases. Now, let's dive into Sri Ram Jha's chess journey. He started chess at the age of 10. His father taught him the game, and his father also accompanied him to a lot of tournaments in the initial years. It was his father's mission to make his son a national champion someday. So Sri Ram Jha fulfilled that mission in 1992 after winning the National Sub Junior Championship at Kerala. Later that year, he went on to represent India in the Asian Sub Juniors in Doha. He was the top seed of the event, and he and Shankar Roy were the only federated players in the event. Interestingly, Rustam Kasim Zanov and Amanatov Farooq also participated in that tournament, and Amanatov Farooq had won the event. Now, Sri Ram Jha is married to India's first woman grandmaster, Vijayalakshmi Subbaraman. So, Vijayalakshmi Subbaraman is an international master and a GM elect. GM elect means that she has completed the prerequisite norms to achieve the GM title. All she needs to do is just touch 2500 rating. So when I asked him about his favorite chess piece, he had the following answer, and I would like to read it out. Favorite chess piece would be the knight, although I am a big supporter of the double bishop advantage. I never noticed it, but my wife, GM elect Viji Subbaraman, tells me that she has seen many of my games where I've played beautifully with the knights, and you know, no husband can go against what his wife believes. Now that answer made me smile. Next, I asked him what his favorite chess opening would be, and he said that it could be Sicilian Dragon, but he's also fascinated by gambits. And he mentions Farovich's gambit, that is d4 knight f6 c4 e5 d takes e5 knight e4. And he feels that his fascination with gambits might end when he returns to over the board chess. And when I asked him about his favorite movies, he said Godfather. He mentioned Pursuit of Happiness, Schindler's List, Guide, Bandini, Madhumati, Andi. These are the movies that came to his mind, and especially the haunting music in the last couple of films that I mentioned. And when I asked him if he has any particular life lesson that he has learned, he said the following. If you don't believe in yourself, nobody else will. Be kind. So he stresses on the importance of being kind. And then the third point was, if it costs your peace of mind, the price is too high. Take care of your health. And then I asked him if he has any idol that he admires. And he said that he admires Vishy Anand because what Vishy has achieved over the years and how gracefully he has conducted himself at the world stage is a huge lesson for all upcoming chess players of her country. So those were the answers of Sri Ram Jha. Now let's return to the chessboard with the games. Here is the first game where Sri Ram Jha was white, and he was playing against Aloysius Quinis. I'm not sure about the pronunciation of the black's name, I'm sorry about that. Here he had just played c5 and his opponent went knight c6, which is slightly dubious. Maybe b4 could have been a better try, and this was also mentioned by Sri Ram Jha in his annotations. After knight c6, bishop e3, rook e8, black believes that he has king's Indian kind of compensation, but the center is open here and white is fully developed, and so white is clearly better. So here Sri Ram Jha has a clear explanation as to why white is better. Just requires one move to connect the rooks, and also white has more space. So after rook e8, he took cd6 and then played rook c1, and after rook c8 he picked up the pawn on d6, and then after b4, knight d5, knight e4, bishop takes e4, rook takes bishop takes e4, if there is rook takes e4 there is a knight b6. So after bishop takes e4, bishop e5 happened, and now in this position he first played knight f6 check, and then after bishop takes f6 he took the piece on c6. So this whole combination was based on that last move, which I am coming to. After rook into c6, rook into c6, rook e6, this was a position I had given you as an exercise prior to the start. And then in this position after rook e6, what will you do as white? if the queen moves to d2, the rook can be easily picked. So you have to choose your move carefully. The correct move in this position is rook d1, supporting the queen. In case of rook takes d6, you play rook cd6, ensuring that you win another piece, and that decides the game in white's favor. In the next position that I'm going to show you, it involves great preparation by Sriram Jha in the Slav defense. So here, this was a mainline Slav, and after 95-97, this line I think became especially popular after Boris Avruk released his book on Slav. All this is traditional theory. Black plays h5 so that he gets some attack going because he has a hook on g3. I'm going directly to the critical position where he plays bishop h6. So he mentions that he had taken only 3 minutes in the game until here, and his opponent had already spent about 70 minutes. And after bishop h6, his opponent played knight e4, and this is where he started thinking for the first time. And here he played rook g8, fascinated by a concept of queen h1 check, bishop takes queen, and knight h2 check. But the king is running to e1, then you have rook g1 mate. So this was the initial idea. So his opponent played knight g5, and then after queen takes h4, his opponent played knight h3. And suddenly he realized that he can still make the idea work, because now there is nobody stopping the g line. So queen takes h3, and then after bishop takes h3, there is knight h2 and king e1, and this rook has a free hand. There's no knight stopping the rook anymore, so rook g1, and then after bishop f1, there is a mate. So this was his game against Xi Daeshun. And then the last one, this is the position where Korni was white and Sriram Jha was black, and this was a position again that I gave you initially, black to move. It's a typical king's Indian position where you need to keep your attack going on the king side. So here Sriram Jha played knight g3. It's a fork here, and white captured hx g3, and then black played fg3. Now this pawn on g3 is going to be a great point for black, because after queen h4 you also have threats like queen h2, which reminds me of Damiano's mate. So after rook fc1, there is queen h4, threatening queen h2 and queen h1 mate. And his opponent played bishop e3 so that the bishop could drop back to g1 in the position. So after pawn to e4, knight e1, he played queen h2 check. Now the reason why he played e4 will be revealed in the next move. So after king f1, queen check, you see bishop is coming to d4. So the pawn push is not only putting pressure on f3, but it's also opening the eyes for the bishop to come to d4. And after queen takes e4, he captured on g1. And after king e2, he played bishop f5. Now this rook will also enter the game if required, and black is winning. So those were the three best games of Sriram Jha, which I really enjoyed covering. I hope you also liked watching the video. Do like the video and do subscribe to our channel if you're here for the first time. We'll be back with some more videos. Until then, take care. Bye-bye.